How over 200 soldiers, lawless DSS operative, killed unarmed people in Igboho's house, stole gold, money, and others, all revealed. Hello, my wonderful people. The story is all out, and then we're hearing from the horse's mouth itself, if you want to call it that way. The horse's mouth itself. How the people that came to Sunday Igboho's house, it was as though it was a battle. Yeah, like it was really a battle. They were going for a battle, and the way they, you know, went into Sunday Igboho's house, all they did will shock you. Over 200. Yeah, do you know Sunday Igboho? Sunday Igboho's, you know, uncle that was blind was in that house. Yeah, a blind man. Sunday Igboho brought him to look after him. Funny enough, they said he came there that day. He got there that day. So what are you talking about? He got there that day. Listen, my guys, we cannot continue, you know, with all the lies by the Attorney General on Sunday Igboho. Keep quiet and pretend that all is well right now. We cannot continue to pretend that way. Okay, we can't. Leave us a comment. We'd love to hear from you. Please don't forget to like us, share, subscribe. Let's get all the details. How over 200 soldiers, lawless DSS operative, killed unarmed people in Sunday Igboho's house, stole gold, money, others. Igboho's house was raided by DSS on July the 1st, killing two of his associates and arresting many others. Oladapo Ademola, one of the 12 associates of the sectionist leader, Sunday Adeyemo, aka Sunday Igboho, has narrated how operative of the Department of State Services, DSS, invaded Igboho's house and killed two people. Igboho's house was raided by DSS on July the 1st, killing two of his associates and arresting many others. Ademola, who told Sunday Punch, he is the director of Sunday Igboho's foundation, accused the DSS of killing people in cold blood during the raid. He was one of those arrested by the DSS and later released. Recalling the raid on Igboho's residence in the Soka area of Ibadan, Oyo State, Ademola said, "We woke up to find ourselves in that mess. It was like a misuse of power by the present government of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. I was being minded my speech about the event of that day because of a lot of us are still suffering from psychological trauma because of what happened that day alone. What happened that day alone can take one's life. My house was not far from Chief Sunday Igboho, and being a father to me, I have access to him. He has access to me. He did call to see me anyway to run an errand for him. I was in my personal house around 12 a.m., but I had a message to pass across to him, which I could not deliver by phone. I moved from my house to his residence at exactly 12 a.m. and met with him. We discussed till about 1 a.m. and we're outside with some of our people till around 1:30 a.m. in his house. I had a chalet that he allocated to me as one of his associates. At exactly 1:30, he moved into his building. Others retreated to their apartment, and I also moved into mine. But exactly 1:35, 5 minutes later, I started hearing gunshots, and I wondered what was happening. My chalet is directly facing the main gate, and I opened the window to peep, to see what was happening outside. To my greatest shock, I couldn't see anyone, but I heard sporadic shooting. Whenever I heard fire, I was wondering who was shooting at the building. As a Muslim, I started reciting different verses of the Quran, believing it might be the end of my life. While still peeping through the window, I could see two DSS personnel inside the house. They came through the fence because they could not force their way in through the main gates from outside. So some of them jumped the fence and came into open the gates for the others. When they opened the gate, I saw that they were dressed in black and were putting on helmets. They were dressed like ninjas. They were on a battlefield facing Boko Haram. I heard them calling themselves, "Coming to two." I immediately woke up the boy that was with me and told him we needed to start preparing for our burial because there was no way to escape. They were over or more than 100 personnel inside the building, comprising of the DSS soldiers. They were shooting sporadically everywhere. When they got to my chalet or any of the room, they fired directly. I started praying, and I am thankful to God that he spared my life that day. The shooting continued for 3 hours. When they got to my chalet, I opened the door for them. They marched on my head on the floor. I had collected around 300 from Chief Sunday Gboho, which I wanted to use to buy something the following morning. One of the soldiers picked up the money. They demanded my gun, and I told them, "Do I look like someone who can shoot? Do I look like someone who can operate a gun?" They mashed my head hard on the ground. Still, I was handcuffed with my head pressed down, one shoe on my head. Then they took me to the gate to lie down with the others. At the gate, to my greatest shock, I saw one of my very own brother and chief executive officer of Olumide Motors in Oshobo in a pool of blood. Likewise, afar, we were still together around 12:30, but the two of them were already gone down, I guess during the sporadic shooting. After we have been handcuffed, they lay us all on the floor. The security operative started destroying the vehicles in the compound, threatening to burn down the house, saying all sorts of things. They also made a roll call of the people in the house what has happened. But to the glory of God, here we are today. The two persons killed we identify as Adesa, popularly called Adegun, and Igboho's maternal uncle. We refer to him as Afar. Denying the claim made by the DSS that the two people killed were armed and they were engaging the operative in a gun battle, Igboho's uncle was a blind man. He brought him to look after him. My dear, I can go on and on and on. You said they went away with the CCTV camera. They went away with the cats. They killed because Igboho has cats in his compound. They killed the other ones and took the big one, believing that Shimson Igboho has turned to the big cat that they took along with them. They went around the compound, took away the CCTV camera. When the DSS could not find Shimson Igboho, they went round. When they could not find him, they brought in their herbalist and started chanting incantation, wanting him to come back. The herbalist later told the DSS that Baba has turned into a cat. And that's why they went for the cats and started killing all the cats in the compound. I believe they knew he had metaphysical powers. That was why they came in with herbalists at all costs. But God was not ready to put his life in their hands. My dear, the story continues on and on. Listen, guys, what is going on is not acceptable. Leave us a comment. We'd love to hear from you. God bless you. Bye for now.